I mean, you come at a time when we have academic members of staff are refusing to teach. I am one of them. We don't want to go back to class. The reason for this is a month ago, one of our colleagues, somebody who, a professor in the Department of Political Studies, was summoned by the Inspector General of Police. Now, Inspector General of Police is the head of police in Malawi. I mean, that's the boss here. He was summoned over some example he gave in class, which seemed to indicate that events in Tunisia or Egypt can be replicated in other countries, including Malawi, if certain things are not done by government. So it was, I think in context, it was within the context of a lecture on political science, public policy, and the impact on society. So I think from all, I mean, in all respects, this was just an ordinary example given in the course of an ordinary lecture.
Can you tell us what the example was?
I think that he was speaking about the definition of public policy and talking about how public policy may be defined as inaction in addition to being action. And he was relating or citing the lack of fuel in Malawi, the lack of foreign exchange, which has existed for some time, as possible indicators of government inaction. And because he had said that events in Tunisia and Egypt could be the result of government inaction as well, the allegation or the accusation by the Inspector General of Police was essentially that he was inciting students to copy what had happened in Tunisia and Egypt to revolt against government in reaction to the shortage of fuel and foreign exchange. So that was the logic which was used.
And what was the response? What happened as a result of that statement in class?
As a result of the statement in class, our view is that somebody within that class took that information to, we don't know whether directly to the police or to somewhere else, but in any case, the information ended up with the police, and the police took the view that this was somehow a threat to national security. So the head of police invited our colleague to his house, apparently, not his office, but his house, and warned him about the dangers of teaching in this manner, giving these kinds of examples, and effectively inciting students. Now, when our colleague reported this to us, we took the view that this was unjustified interference with academic freedom. Freedom to teach, the freedom to research, the freedom to learn without undue interference and undue threats. So as a result of that, we organized a march to the police station, local police station, where we delivered a petition to be handed to the Inspector General of Police, in which we demanded that he apologizes to the academic members of staff here, he apologizes to the specific professor whom he had invited to his house, but also that he give an unequivocal statement guaranteeing that the police would not interfere with academic freedom in future.
And what was the response of the police to that?
His response was that academic freedom has to be balanced against national security. Now, we took the view that that was stating the obvious and that that wasn't the issue at all, because our view was that our colleague did not in any way threaten national security. So that was really a completely irrelevant response in our view. But he then went on to justify his questioning of our colleague by saying that the police have a right to interview anyone in connection with any possible commission of a crime. In our view, no crime had been committed, not even close, and so there was no justification. As a result of that, we found the response by the Inspector General unsatisfactory and decided that we would no longer go into class until we had that reassurance that we would be left free to do our job, would be left free, like any academic, to engage in academic discourse without worrying about the consequences of what I may say. So while we are prepared to act within the law, but we are not prepared to act with a threat or with expansive police interference with the way we do things. We are not going to work, in our view, in a situation where practically, we are being asked that the material we use for teaching be censored by the police or any authority.
Have there been responses from the government since you've made that decision not to teach?
There have been a number of responses. The most interesting response has been by the president, who also, by coincidence, happens to be the current chancellor of the University of Malawi. Now, his view of the matter is that the police were justified, that he, in fact, has suggested that to some extent we don't understand academic freedom, and that what we are demanding is academic anarchy. We disagree completely, and because of that, we continue to insist that we want to be guaranteed our academic freedom, which, by the way, is guaranteed by our constitution. So it's not like we are demanding something that comes from somewhere. It's not foreign, it's nothing. It is guaranteed by our constitution, but we also believe it's a universal value that is recognized by all international human rights agreements that relate to human rights, academic freedom, liberty, and so on.
What do you want academics around the world to understand about this situation?
I think what we want academics around the world to understand is that this is not something that should be seen as a matter that only involves academics in Malawi. Academic freedom, as far as we're concerned, is universal, is inseparable. I think the attack, any attack on academic freedom anywhere on earth is an attack on academic freedom anywhere else. Because although the specifics of this relate to Malawi, but I think that academics all over the world will realize or will recognize the danger that comes with claims of national security as a basis for restricting the space for academic discourse, academic research, freedom of expression generally. So we want to, I think my view would be that academics around the world should recognize that this is just an example of the dangers to academic freedom that exist all over the world, and not just in this part of the world.
Is there anything that academics around the world can do to help?
Yes. I think the first would be to bring more attention to the situation in Malawi, because we are a small country, not many people read about us. So I think that's the first, just to make the world aware that there is this happening. But also, I think for academics around the world to get in touch with people within our own government here in Malawi who have been academics elsewhere. I mean, I can give an example of the current Minister of Education in Malawi, who is a well-respected academic, who has worked in the United States, I think has worked at a number of American universities, for his colleagues to get in touch with him and say, is there anything you can do within your powers to assist the academics of Malawi safeguard their freedom, to assist academics in Malawi to guard their territory? I think those kinds of interventions would probably help. But to a large extent, of course, the primary responsibility lies with Malawian academics to fight for the boundaries of their territory. But I think the support from academics all over the world is not only desirable, I think it's necessary at this stage.
Anything else that we should know before we go about the situation?
Well, that there are attempts that are being made to resolve it, so it's not beyond redemption. That academics are doing this boycott of classes with heavy hearts, because a lot of us have actually worked as academics for a long time, and it breaks our hearts at the personal level to see our students loitering on campus and not be able to teach them, because we think that there is a higher value that has to be safeguarded. So I think that's that at the personal level, it is a difficult decision for any academic at all to abandon their students, but that we believe that the value at stake here justifies it.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.